you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid. I go before you always. Come, follow me, and I will give you rest. If you pass through raging waters, in the sea you shall not drown. If you walk amid the burning flames, you shall not be harmed. If you stand before the power of hell and death is at your side, know that I am with you through it all. Be not afraid. I go before you always. Come, follow me, and I will give you rest. Blessed are the poor, for the kingdom shall be theirs. Blessed are you.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this celebration of life. I'm Pastor Marvin Seaborg, and I'm truly honored to be able to officiate this service for Joyce today. We are gathered here today to celebrate the life and to honor the memory of Joyce Jennings. Today, we do one of the most difficult things to do. We gather to mourn the passing of a very dear woman, Joyce, a wonderful person, and to many of us, a great friend. Grief is never an easy burden to bear, and never more so when it comes to us when we have to only say our final goodbye to our loved one. It causes to arise within us many, many questions. Questions about ourselves and what we might or might not have done to make things different in this situation. Questions about the one we loved and just what it was that she experienced during all of her days. And questions also about God and God's goodness to her in her life here on earth. We will have here today some wonderful, wonderful and great memories, happy thoughts, sad thoughts, seeking to paint the best picture we can of our emotions and of our loss. We gather in such grief today, carrying a burden that not only seems to be, but in fact is totally overwhelming. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, knew such grief when he walked among us. He understood and also took upon himself our pain and our sorrow, our sin and our guilt, our fear and our anger, and in the end died the earth. It was with such faith in God and what God would accomplish through him that he said to his disciples before his death and his resurrection, "Tears are not a sign of weakness, but as we all know, that tears are a sign of love, and in this case, the love for Joyce. And let there be talking, and let there be sharing. Talk about Joyce's life, and talk about her death. This helps in accepting the reality of the tragedy and the grief work that's being done. When death occurs, we know that those whom we have lost are now at peace. Be thankful for the friendship you had with Joyce. Nothing can change the experiences that you shared with her. The past is secure and cannot be changed by time or circumstances. So we come today in our grief, in our pain, in our anger, in our doubt, in our confusion. But we come to ask God to take our burden from us and give us in its place the burden Christ spoke of. We come to ask God to be merciful to us and to Joyce and grant us new life here, and the new life Jesus spoke of in the heavenly places that has been prepared for us. On behalf of the family, I take this opportunity to thank all of you for coming and being a part of this celebration of life. Memorial donations in memory of Joyce will go to the Central Butte Ivor Main Place, Box 550 in Central Butte. You can either get an envelope at the back of the chapel and leave it here, or you can mail it in directly to the Central Butte Ivor Main. The only thing, as I ask, if you mail it in directly, please put in there that it's in memory of Joyce. Following the service today, you're invited to follow out to the cemetery. We're going to Rosedale Cemetery. And one thing I do caution you as we make our way out, please obey all traffic regulations as we go out to the cemetery. The days of, you know, the just driving out, lights flashing, all that kind of stuff, and you just make your way out quick and easy, it doesn't happen. You have to follow stop signs, lights, and all that. So be cautious as we leave the chapel here today. So as we come together, let's just open now in a word of prayer. Faithful Father, we thank you that you are the Lord of life. We praise you that we are made in your image, reflecting your truth and light. We thank you for the life of Joyce Jennings, the love she received from you and the love with which she loved each of us. We wait with eager anticipation for the resurrection of the dead at the return of Jesus Christ. We thank you that we will share with all your people in a world with no sin, pain, or death. We long to see you face to face and be reunited with our loved ones. Today, Lord, we give praise and thanks for the celebration of life service for Joyce Jennings. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as some may have followed the tribute or the obit that was put onto the computer, I'd like to share this part with you at this time. It is with heavy hearts that we announce the passing of Joyce Ellen Jennings on Friday, April 2nd, 2021, at the age of 90 years at Pioneer Lodge here in Moose Jaw. Joyce was born August 23rd, 1930 in Central Butte to Lorne and Gladys Akins. She was their fourth child after Cliff, Lorne, and Nora, and was followed by little brother Glenn. She grew up in the Green Prairie School District, where she took her elementary grades. At the age of just 17, she completed a six-week course at Moose Jaw Normal School, and she went teaching at N School in Needpath, Saskatchewan. Joyce and Vic Hausman eloped to Toronto, Ontario, and were married March 28, 1949. They lived in Toronto for 2 years and then moved back to Central Butte, where Vic operated a contracting business. Vic built many houses in Central Butte, and Joyce did the accounting for the business. Lorne joined their family in 1951 and Gord in 1955. Sadly, Vic passed away suddenly from a heart attack on January 22, 1969, at a very young age of 52 years old. This left Joyce alone with the two sons. She appreciated all the support she received from family, friends, community, and particularly a great friend, Reverend Gordon and Dot Duncan. Joyce worked as a town administrator from 1966 to 1971, and then at the post office from 1976 to 1990. Joyce was fortunate to meet George Jennings, and they were married in July 1970. She became a farm wife in the Aquadel district for the next 20 years. They did lots of traveling, enjoying many trips to the United States and to Europe. They welcomed their first grandson in 1981 and were thrilled to have three more grandsons and a granddaughter. They spoiled them all, every chance they got. Joyce loved to entertain, always serving up delicious meals and hosting many a Pinocchio game with her siblings, which at times could get a little bit heated. She was very involved and dedicated to her community, belonging to the Central Butte Hospital Auxiliary, and was on the first executive of the Regency Manor Auxiliary in 1984. Joyce was secretary and treasurer for the Central Butte Recreation Board and worked very hard on the committee for the swimming pool that her grandchildren would enjoy in later years. From 1993 to 1999, she was a member of the first Thunder Creek Health Board. In 2000, she was elected to the Providence Place Board, and she became extensively involved until 2006. George and Joyce decided to move to Regina in 2002, where they were thankful to be with George's, when George's health started to fail. He passed away on December 19, 2007. Joyce then moved back to Moose Jaw in October 2011 to be closer to her family. She made many new friends at Crestview Manor, including a very close friend, Tony. During her time in Moose Jaw, she was able to spend quality time with her brother, Cliff, and special niece, Glenda. Due to some health issues, she moved to Ivermain in Central Butte in May of 2015. It was so wonderful to have her home again, and she settled in making new friends and renewing friendships in town. Being a community-minded person, she was always interested in the town. She loved all the visitors that took the time to visit her, especially when she got to go to April's for lunch and ice cream. I know she loved that. She always told me that. Being cut off from her family in 2020 due to COVID-19 restrictions caused her health to decline very rapidly. Sadly, the last year of her life was spent for the most part alone. She loved to visit with many friends and relatives on the phone, as that was the only source of contact that she could have at this point. She was blessed with three great-grandchildren, and even as her health failed, her face would light up every time we walked about Maya, James, and Bryn. She was predeceased by her parents, Lauren and Gladys, husbands Vic and George, and siblings Cliff, Lauren, Nora, and Glenn. Joyce is survived by her sons, Lauren Hausman and Gord and Karen Hausman, grandchildren Joel, Lonnie, Josh, Jared, Danielle, Leah, Dion, and Eric, Melissa, great-grandchildren Maya, James, and Bryn, as well as many nieces and nephews. At this time now, I'd like to just share some memories that have been written by some of from the grandchildren. First of all, Eric. I remember going over to her house for suppers and gatherings, how she always loved to be surrounded by her friends and family. Leah, my favorite memory of Grandma is that she always used to call me her favorite granddaughter because I was her only granddaughter. I used to call her my favorite grandmother because she was my only grandmother. That, and she taught me to make scuffles and make them every year now for Christmas. Joel, my memory of Grandma, Jay, would be when we were kids and would go over to her house Christmas morning for breakfast. Was always fun having breakfast with them, Uncle Glenn, Cliff, Mary. She always spoiled us at Christmas. I also remember when I worked at Spears in Regina, I would often go to her place for lunch. Homemade soup, buns, good conversation, and a little bit of a debate. Josh, first of all, I would like to thank you for everything that you did to help raise us boys. I know that likely wasn't always the easiest task. I always remember sneaking over to your basement Saturday morning to Nickelodeon on the dish because it had the best cartoons. We learned to ride bikes at your place and down the hill on your driveway, which later led to jumps and a few injuries. I always remember how excited we were to get to your place on Christmas morning. We could never open our presents until we finished our breakfast, so I was pretty excited when we ditched pretending to eat the Christmas casserole and went to the delicious waffles with bacon instead. One of the things that reminds me of you most is golf, though. You bought me my first ever golf membership and continue to do so every year for my birthday until I wasn't a junior anymore. I fell in love with golf and always was thankful that you gave me that opportunity to play as much as I could. I've never forgot that. I will forever be thankful for everything you did for us. I love you. Jared, I remember growing up, she always spoiled us from getting me that first CD player to cooking amazing brunch on Christmas morning. We were very fortunate to have Grandma Jay at such close proximity as she lived just across the alley. I remember when she left to Regina, we would often visit her at the condo downtown, and we began to make new memories. She would take us to our favorite Chinese restaurant every year right around Christmas, and that was very special. She always took care of us, no doubt about it, even after it was hard to prepare a Christmas feast. It was nice being able to visit you back in Central Butte later on when you went to stay at the Ivermain. I'll miss you, Grandma, and I hope you are in a better place. Lauren, I will remember how you always looked out for me. You would call me every night and ask about my day. It was nice to be able to tell you about work at Sarkan and what was going on in my life. And this one is now from Karen. It's written in a poem fashion. To my other mother, you are the mother I received the day I wed your son and just went to thank you, Mom, for the loving things you've done. You've given me a gracious man with whom I share my life. You are his lovely mother and I his lucky wife. You used to pat his little head, and now I hold his hand. You raised in love a little boy, and then gave me the man. I made this cross stitch for her 1 year for Christmas, and she loved it. I made every move with her and hung on the wall wherever she went. She welcomed me into the family back in 1974 with open arms. I think she hoped I would keep Gord out of trouble. Were you a bad boy, Gord? She taught me more things over the years. Lots of good recipes and still make to this day. And she tried to teach me how to garden, but that wasn't a successful task. She was very good to me and the best mother-in-law I could ever have asked for. I loved her dearly. It was so hard to watch her failing, but even then, she appreciated everything I did for her. Rest easy. I miss you already. And this one is from Gord. Mom, I'm going to use a line stolen from my beautiful cousin, Glenda. When we leave this earth, all we have is our legacy. Well, Mom, yours is stiller. Your love of family, your community involvement, serving on many boards, both locally and provincially, trying to make the community a better place to live. Your generosity to family and friends alike, many family meals with the Aikens clan or Jennings clan or whoever. Your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren always brought a smile to your face, and you always spoke of them with pride. I know there is a special place for you right outside, alongside the others that went before you. You faced all your battles with dignity and grace, especially the last year when we couldn't see you as much as we would have liked to. Even the last month when you were struggling, you did it with dignity. Know that you are loved and definitely will be missed. You are free now, Mom. Fly high until we meet again. Thank you, everybody, for these wonderful tributes that you each shared. And a couple names there are words. I've never heard of these games, so I pardon myself for maybe not pronouncing them correctly. At this time, I would like to watch on our overhead here. We're going to watch a slide presentation.
Didn't know today would be our last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. pray and you just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah.
gathered round your grave to grieve. Wish I could see angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice.
At this time, I would like to call upon Colleen Mortimer to come forward. She's going to share the reading from Scripture, John 5, verse 24 to 28.
Very truly, I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. Very truly I tell you, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to judge, because he is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice.
Thank you, Colleen. The message for today that I'd like to share with you is taken from Romans chapter 8, verse 35 to 38. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? But in all these things we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we gather here today to remember the life of Joyce. We We also gather to say goodbye one last time and celebrate the life that she enjoyed here on earth, and to thank you for each precious moment and memory that we have had with her. Her life has touched so many in so many different ways. We pray that your peace and presence will be upon us during this time, and we pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. As we gather here this afternoon to celebrate and to remember the dear and precious life of Joyce, I know that many of you are dealing with very, very mixed emotions. On the one hand, there are emotions of great sadness. Sadness not for Joyce, because Joyce is in a far better place, but sadness because we have lost a dear loved one of our family and our friendship. But on the other hand, there is great joy, knowing that because of the relationship that Joyce had with her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that she has already been in his presence, for as Scripture has spoken to us about this. In 2 Corinthians 5, verse 6 to 8, it says, "So we are always confident, knowing that we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, yes, well pleased, rather to be absent from the body and to be present with our Lord." And for the Christian, there is no greater joy than to be present of the one that loves them like no one else can. You see, Joyce had a relationship that carried some wonderful promises, both that we have shared with through Scripture. Joyce was not created to be someone whose name would be scattered all over the paper. She'd done something greater than that by being on the cover of your heart and my heart. There have been several testimonies of how this meek and humble woman has made a tremendous impact in the lives of others, in that was shared with us here this afternoon. Over the many years that I've been privileged to know Joyce, many thoughts come to mind for me. And of the times we come together, I would bring her prayer time, the sermons, the Bible reading, the gift of music, and share all these special times together when she was living in the Ivermain. Also, communion every second month was important to her, also right up to the very end of her life when she was not able to be able to take communion. But we still shared in the words of the gospel, and the most beautiful part was when it came to prayer time. Joyce was always so thankful for the services, for her family, her friends, and also her surroundings. We always had a coffee and a good visit before we went to our worship time at the Ivor. She always waited so patiently at that table, looking out the window and wondering, "Where's Marie and Pastor Marvin? They should be here soon." Well, when the roads were good, there was no problem. But when the roads were bad, it took a little longer to get there. So she always wondered, "Are they coming? Are they coming?" "Oh, yes, we'll be there in just a few minutes." But one thing I can surely say is that if God planted a seed in a person, the greatest germination took place in this lovely lady. She was very church-orientated, minded, and whether it be in active service, she was always there, always listening to the gospel, always listening to what God is saying to her. And boy, she never missed. "Thank you, Pastor Marvin, for coming. All the way from Moose Jaw? Well, Joyce, it's not too far. I'm happy to bring the word to you." And she appreciated that so much. She blessed you in each of your visits. And I have to share with you at this point, I tried to do church when I was doing church in Chaplin. And so I thought, well, I'll come over to the Ivor and do church on Sunday afternoon. Well, you, the family, kind of put a crimp into that. She says, "I'm not coming to church when my family's coming." So I had to chuckle. So we had to re-ramp that church service to a Friday. And there Joyce was. But she just wasn't going to miss any of you coming to visit her because of that church service. So anyways, it worked out good. We had great, great time. But I always chuckled about that because there was a couple other residents, the same thing. She was a woman who looked forward to her trials to find some way to brighten somebody else's day. But nothing that happened to Joyce surprised God, because God was active in Joyce's life for many, many years, long before maybe Joyce became active even in God. God knew that Joyce was going to be special from the moment she entered this world that she lived in, because he intended for her to be that special person. But also God knew that he had given her a specific number of days for her to live, and that he fully expected her to return one day. We, on the other hand, simply take everything so for granted, way too often, that we will always have each other around. And we will fail to appreciate the incredible, special person that God placed in our lives, who was Joyce. I know for sure that, basically, Joyce had some very dear friends in both the Ivor and maybe some in the Manor too. But it was the type of thing that you could tell that they enjoyed their coffee together, they enjoyed their meals together, they enjoyed their visits together. We even make the mistake of thinking that we ourselves are going to be here forever. Well, give that noggin a little shake, because we're not. We have a number of days too to live and be on this earth. And so Joyce was really blessed, because she recognized that death is a certain reality for every one of us, and it can hit us at any moment, no matter what the age may be. If we are all living in order that we might live someday, then we should do a reality check and make us think about maybe today is our last day, tomorrow, the next day could be our last. We want to live our life to its fullest. But who do we want to live our life to? Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, because he's the one that's blessed each one of us with such great and wonderful honor. As we come together today, Joyce realized there was one person that really, really meant a lot to her. She made a decision to start to live her life for Christ, and that was important to her. You can see all the excellent qualities in her. She was a very loving person, and anyone around Joyce could feel that warmth through that conversation. She always made you feel important, that it was important that you were there for her. This very special lady, whom God has created, is now back in the arms of God. And I know for sure one person there at the Ivor, they were just like two peas in a pod, and that was her and Marilyn. They traveled together, they visited together, they knew every move that each other was making. That was a true friendship, and they were a blessing. And I was at the Ivor just about 2 weeks ago. You know, Marilyn's still feeling that loss. She said, I can't basically fathom that Joyce has been taken from the Ivor to the Manor, now to Pioneer Lodge. And then just in the last few days, she realized that Joyce had passed away. It was hard. It was sad, because that was her friend. So as we come together, we always hurt to lose that special gift. But it's never wrong to lose that gift to be back in the arms of our Lord. We are never without hope, for God gives us a message of encouragement and hope. Maybe it will lead us to encourage who God is and what God has in store for every one of us. Joyce knew God created her, God walked with her, and yet in those final moments, God called her home. Sometimes we don't understand when we lose a special person in our lives, but somehow, like the Apostle Paul, he spoke and he says, Joyce Jennings could very, very proudly declare, the time has come for my departure. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Jesus had gone forth to prepare a place for her. But like Joyce, you and I have to make that choice. Do we want to go to be back with the Lord? I hope and pray you do, because that is a great and wonderful reward. So none of us knows the day nor the hour, but this time that we share here today to say our final goodbye, her decision made her not only special, but also very important to each of our lives. For her fame of eternity in heaven will be remembered for generations after the important people of this world have long since been wiped from the pages of history. Joyce, you have been called to your new eternal home, to be with your husbands and other family members and friends. So please, rest in peace, Joyce. We all will truly miss you in our place of worship, in our families, in our community, and also as a true family member. Keep watch over us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we're going to listen now to a music selection. And as we listen to this selection, I want you to think, how did Joyce's life impact each one of us? As we listen to I Come to the Garden.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. Tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him. The night around me is falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling. Tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry,
let us bow our heads in a word of prayer at this time. God of grace and glory, we truly thank you, Lord, for the life of Joyce, who was so near and dear to every one of us and who has now been taken from us. We thank you, Lord, for the friendship she gave and for the strength and peace she brought. Lord, we come to you today to thank you for the love that Joyce offered and received while she was with us here on this earth. We pray that nothing truly good in her life will be lost, but it will be a total benefit to each and every one of us now that she has moved to her new eternal home. We pray for all of the family, Lord. We pray that it's hard to understand death, but yet the life that Joyce lived with and around each one of us was a total blessing. Lord, we also need to pray for ourselves, who are severely tested by this death, that we do not try to minimize this loss or seek refuge from it in words alone, and also that we do not brood over it so that it overwhelms us and isolates us from this. Please, Lord, now grant us grace to entrust Joyce Jennings to your never-failing love which sustained her in this life. Receive Joyce into the arms of your mercy, and remember her according to the favor that you bear for all of your people. Lord, we also come today with many great and wonderful thanksgiving for all of the staff that looked after Joyce at all the care facilities, the nurses, the doctors, the care aides. And also we thank you, Lord, for each of the family members that stood by her and journeyed with her through this very challenging time.